Good morning. May the grace and peace of Jesus Christ be with each and every one of you on this Lord's Day. We are so blessed to have you in the presence to worship amongst you. Today is a special day, not only for myself, but for our church. And if you're wondering what it looks like Pentecost in here, perhaps you have never seen an ordination yet, but ordination colors are red, just like Pentecost. So it's the same idea that we're celebrating the Holy Spirit coming and bringing gifts to those who are called each and uniquely. So I am so grateful for the beautiful Pentecost red in the sanctuary this morning. So if you're wondering, if you're a bit of a liturgical nerd like myself, you might be confused. Yes, it's still ordinary time, but we just went ahead and went with it. We're in a celebratory mood all day. So I invite you on behalf of the Presbytery of Western North Carolina to join us again this afternoon at 3 p.m. For my ordination and installation. It is an immense blessing. I don't think there's any words in any language to explain how I feel, how my family feels about this day. It is a blessing. It is amazing. And we're just in awe of what God has done for us and where he has led us here to serve in Banner Elk at this time. Again, just no words, I don't think, in any human language to explain how amazed and blessed we feel today. Directly following this worship service today, it's a big day. We have a congregational meeting that has been called to vote on the sale of a property. So if you would please just stay for just 5 minutes brief, we're going to try to just get it done and vote on the sale of a property this morning. Reverend Ed Donnell will be opening that meeting because I will not be ordained until 3 p.m. today. Just squeezing one more thing in for Ed, and we're grateful for his presence. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. Will you please join me in the responsive call to worship as found in your bulletin? God, you satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love.
So we may rejoice and be glad all our days.
Let your servants see your glory, the ways you lead, and bless your children.
Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us, and prosper for us the work of our hands.
For all good things come from the Lord. Let us worship God in his name with gratitude. If you please rise, join me in the singing of hymn 631 in the presence of your people. Join me now, please, in praying in unison the corporate prayer of confession. Our God, who sees all and knows all, we come before you knowing that we can hide nothing from you. There are no secrets or lies that we can conceal. We confess that we have held onto what you have given with tight fists. We admit that there are gifts, talents, wealth, and time that we are not able to give. Grow the kingdom, feed the hungry, house the orphan, comfort the sick and lonely. That when you have extended your hand and given us the opportunity to go with you, we turn the other way. Forgive us. We come before you this day, ready to follow you. Prepare our hearts for the journey. Friends, hear the good news. When the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of any works of righteousness that we had done, but according to his mercy, through the water of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. The Spirit he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we have become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Amen. Thank you.
Children who want to join me up front for our time for children, I welcome you. Otherwise, I'll do it for our friends at home. We all have gifts. Some of us are really gifted, like Miss Nina and Mr. David, with music, and they share those gifts every Sunday and probably every day with their family and friends, with playing music and singing. It's really beautiful. We have other friends, like our comfort makers, who can sew, and they make these beautiful, they're called pyramids, it's a big word, and they make these beautiful decorations for our sanctuary, and they make beautiful quilts for those who need some warmth and comfort. Today is a special day because we are celebrating a gift that God has called me, which is talking, speaking, proclaiming, and I am grateful for that gift. And so you can see those gifts your entire life. My parents are here this morning, and they would say that I was always telling stories. So maybe you have a little pastor in your midst if your children, your grandchildren are constantly talking. You can always pray about that. I have in my hand another gift that people have. It is another beautiful gift of weaving, and this is a stole from Guatemala, and some people wove this, and they have beautiful talents. And I get to wear this afternoon after I'm ordained, because then this symbolizes that God has given me the gift to serve as your pastor. And so in order to receive that gift, I wear this other beautiful gift that celebrates what we have. God has given us all good things to do. Some of us can run fast. Some of us can color and draw really well. Some of us can tell stories. Some of us are quiet, but we care for others, and we give the best hugs, and we love one another well. I want us all this morning to think about and celebrate the gifts that God has given you, because that's what today is about. That's what the dove that you see everywhere, it represents the Holy Spirit coming down and lighting that fire in you to recognize the gifts that God has given you. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you so much for this beautiful morning. The beautifulness of each day reminds us how much you love us. And because you love us, you have given us unique gifts and talents. May we serve your whole creation with those gifts and talents. May we love well. May we share our art. May we share our energy. May we share our time so that everyone knows how much we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, come. Open our hearts and our minds for what you have to say to us through your word. May the meditations of our hearts and the words of my mouth be pleasing and acceptable to you. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our first reading is from the Old Testament. If you want to follow along in your Bibles or on your phone, we have Bibles underneath our pews or beside you. I invite you to read and to listen to the Word of God in Job chapter 23, verses 8 through 12. If I go forward, he is not there. Or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, and I cannot see him. But he knows the way that I take. When he has tested me, I shall come out like gold. My foot has held fast to his steps, and I have kept his way and have not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured in my bosom the words of his mouth. But he stands alone, and who can dissuade him? What he desires, that he does. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading this morning is from the Gospel of Mark. Chapter 10, verses 17 through 31. Again, I invite you to listen to the word and wisdom of our Lord. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before Jesus and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give me the money to the poor, and then you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news who will not receive 100-fold now in this age houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." This is the word of God for the people of God. I am grateful for the lectionary, the wisdom and careful and almost sneaky way the story of Job's lament is placed together with the story of the rich young ruler. The story of Job often speaks to us about those situations where we have no control, where we earnestly seek the presence and the voice of God and receive back what we perceive as silence. Job is described as an example of steadfast faith, someone who, despite all the riches and respect he has amassed, he knew that God was the greatest and most reliable source of strength and stability in his life. He was tested by no choice of his own, and yet he clung to God. On the other side of the coin, this morning we have the rich young ruler, a young man whose life was defined by adhering to God's law and enjoying his life full of power and resources. However, there was this large gap in his life: surrender. Perhaps he felt that by living an honest life, he was already making a righteous and faithful sacrifice to the Lord, and his earthly blessings, worthy reward. That seems straightforward enough. And God certainly brings wealth to some of his servants in the course of their lives, but what was missing from the rich young ruler's spirit was surrender of the one thing that he thought protected him outside of God. Jesus approached us as both the Lord and Savior of humanity, and while humbly serving others and teaching them to listen for the word of God. In his sacrifice, he opened heaven to us, but for his experience here on earth, he was born lowly, a tradesman. And his disciples cover the breadth of the socioeconomic spectrum. We are not looking at Jesus as a man who gave up earthly riches, a wife, a children, land. Jesus is someone who deeply knows that surrender to faith does not always have such obvious sacrifices. For the disciples of Jesus, throughout time, there would be women and men who would utilize their gifts and riches to further the kingdom of God, or give the only thing of true value that they owned, themselves. In Jesus, we see the diverse walks of life coming together, and we see their surrender. God knows what in our life we need to let go in order to see Christ first and foremost as our Savior. We often struggle with the difference between right action and right intention. In our time, there's also this added layer of right perception, how others perceive us, the narrative we weave for ourselves, utilizing our friend group, our community, and social media. Action, intention, and perception.
Why Job? And why not the rich young ruler? Job was a rich man, blessed in land, status, a spouse, and children. On paper, Job looked accomplished and respectable. Job was wealthy. Everyone could see. At a certain point, wealth becomes hard to disguise, especially in ancient times. Wealth wasn't invested in money markets, bank accounts, and houses thousands of miles away. Job did not drive a favorite beat-up old pickup truck to divert suspicions, attention, and judgment. He owned thousands of animals. He most likely had hundreds, possibly thousands of workers. From Job chapter 1, verse 3, this man was the greatest in the East. What set Job apart to God was the juxtaposition between what people perceived to be a blessing and what Job knew to be a blessing. Job not only feared the Lord, but he also recognized the power of God's love and forgiveness. He knew God could see his heart, and he knew God heard his prayers. What happened to the rich young ruler is that he believed in the merit of his own actions. As he knelt before Jesus, he could affirm that his life was filled with good actions and the repression and avoidance of bad ones. It is good to do good things. No harm comes from right action. But what matters is in your heart. What is your intention? It is possible that the rich young ruler only understood the world through the lens of reward. That is, in which you make good decisions, and then good things come from those decisions, because you essentially have earned them. You have paid good for good, the account is settled, and the rewards come pouring down. It is a posture and a mindset of transaction. Transactional relationships can be a mile wide, but cannot be more than an inch deep. Because transactional relationships end when one person does not hold their end of the bargain. When we enter transactional relationships, we know the relationship has an end date. For whenever the give and take stops functioning, whenever the currency runs out, that person can be removed and discarded. Healthy relationships have to have systems in place for when humanity comes into play. Everyone drops the ball, disappoints, forgets, lashes out, lies and hides. It looks different for each person. And Satan knows what to tempt us with to individually sabotage our relationships and take our strength and fortitude. In a healthy relationship, you have the tools like forgiveness, reconnection, humility, and giving grace. It does not look like always waiting for one shoe to drop, expecting to be let down. Rather, it is creating love and trust that can sustain and power us through the hardest of days. And it is work. Just ask anyone who has been married for any amount of time, any long-term friendship, or business partnership. Unconditional love and support means sometimes you have to let go. Sometimes you have to surrender. Sometimes you have to take a moment. A transactional relationship does not leave room for any of those, because if there is a debt, it must be paid, or the relationship itself goes into default. The intention is that you only give what you expect to get back. And when you get nothing or find yourself on the receiving end of something bad, you want to walk away. With man, it is impossible, but not with God. for all things are possible with God. When you are working with God, the possibilities become endless and there are no limits. All of our actions have limits. There are only so many boxes of food we can unpack. There are only so many nights we could stay up in a vigil of prayer. There are only so many people we can mentor. And certainly, our money can run out if we give to every single person who asks. But God knows that our value is not solely rooted in our output, in what we can produce, in what our two hands can build. Our value comes from being children of God that are called by his name. We bring blessing and honor to God when we look at him in awe and wonder and say, okay, God, use me. Whatever it is, use me. My heart is yours. Whatever I have, it's yours. My present, my future is yours. Jesus had love and compassion for the rich young ruler. Jesus knows how deeply hard it is, what the cost is, the difficulty to let go and let God. Everyone saw the rich young ruler's actions, but Jesus could see into his heart and know his intentions. And there was something standing in the way, something that prevented the young man from saying, yes, from this moment, I will follow you. Jesus posed the offer, already knowing the answer. You lack one thing. Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Come, follow me. As we can see from Job, it is not wealth that gets in the way of all who have amassed great possessions. It is the hold that those possessions have on our heart. The security, the power, the assurance, the direction, the diversion, and the acclaim. Perception. What do others see when they look at us? To the human eye, we can control perception. Our actions can be carefully curated, and we can choose how and when people see us, what feelings we want others to feel when they see us. What are those feelings? Admiration? Kindness? Success? Athleticism? Uniqueness? It is not bad to want to look your best. It is not bad to want to do your best. But perception is a growing currency. There are more ways than ever to be seen. And in a small town, perception has always been more of a currency than in other places. It's harder to be anonymous, sneak in and sneak out unnoticed. Now that I'm a pastor, I find myself smiling quite often about the time that I ran into my pastor at the grocery store. Normally, I never think twice about getting what I want to get, slipping in and slipping out unnoticed. In my hometown of Georgetown, when I moved back as an adult, there were about 48,000 people. Quite a jump from around 25,000 people that were there when I was a child. 48,000 people. That's quite a few people. But I would continuously run into my pastor at the grocery store. The first time, it was quite jarring. Our carts nearly collided, and we were both most likely in our heads, not really paying attention to our surroundings. Then there was an awkward stop, a smile, and then a glance. Are they looking in my cart? And what aisle were we in, you might ask? Which aisle did I run into my Baptist pastor in? Wine and cheese adjacent. So the glances were noticeable.
I was a Montessori teacher at the time, so my only thoughts were, do I have healthy food in my car? We exchanged pleasantries, and I asked him if he ran into congregants often. Then he asked me if I ran into students often. I laughed, and I said, yes, all the time. Then he said, don't judge me for what's in my cart. Expensive cheese, that was it. I said the same, cookies and ice cream. From that moment on, the anonymity of grocery shopping was gone for me. Perception is a strong force. The combination of action and perception, we are either fighting it, manipulating it, or ignoring it. One of the most miraculous things that happens when we declare faith in Jesus Christ is that when God looks at us, he sees Christ Jesus in us. How God perceives us is in the light of Christ. We are justified in Christ. But sanctification is the miraculous process of the transformation of our intentions. Our actions are forgiven, our perception is in the glorious light of Christ, and our intentions are to be taught, inspired, refined, and led by the Holy Spirit. Our dear friend Job, his actions, his intentions, and his perceptions were all colored by his steadfast faith and awesome fear of God. Consider Job. Clothes torn, covered in sores, ash, and sackcloth. Consider his faith. God knows the way that I take. When he has tried me, I shall come out as gold. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my portion of food. But he is unchangeable. And who can turn him back? What he desires, he does. Job knows that the relationship with the holy cannot be transactional. We cannot be in transaction with God, for we have nothing to give that is truly ours. There's nothing to trade with God. With God is a relationship that is unconditional through Christ. God looks at us and sees glorious potential. God loves us. This big, unchangeable, unstoppable God has given us everything we need for eternal life, for a blessed life, for a life worth living here and in eternity. Intention. For sanctification, we must posture ourselves in intention. We must clear out space in our hearts and in our mind for the Holy Spirit to come. Create in me a pure heart, O God. The grace of Christ was not cheap. The rich young ruler knew that. He knew what his intentions were. He knew that his actions did not change the perception of how Christ saw him. And that grieved him so. On face value, this gospel story might come across that the price of following Christ has an actual material value cost. That might be how some perceive it. When we encounter Jesus, there is nothing that we can hide. Where our hope, where our security, where our love, where our hate lies is all laid out before God. And the cost is of revealing those things. Even in the quiet spaces of our time alone with God, that can seem too costly to bear. The good news is,
The good news is, with humanity it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God. With God. With God. If you are doing things for God, pause and ask God to join you. Action. Intention. Ask yourself honestly, what drives you? What brings you security, comfort, joy, and why? Perception. Consider Job, his sores, his ashes, his sackcloth. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. In Jesus' upside-down kingdom, we can only pray to understand. Pray for the Holy Spirit to come and rejoice in the fact that we do not have to contend with the powers of this world nor the condemnation of God. He paid attention to us and sent us Jesus, his Son. What a price to pay. Amen. At this time, I ask you to join us and stand as you are able to affirm our faith, as in found in the scripture of 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. The saying is sure, if we have died with Christ, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Please remain standing and join with me in singing hymn 834, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Through the action of giving our tithes and offering to grow the kingdom and the love of Christ, both here in Banner Elk and through all of the missions that God has given this church, far and wide. Open your hearts and give cheerfully as God has given to us.
Thank you.
doxology. Gracious God, giver of all good things, giver of life, giver of hope, bless these tithes and offering. We lift them up to you. We extend our hand and say, God, lead us. We will go with you. May we use these in faithfulness and to spread the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Now is the time where we pray for both our community, our church, and the world. Please pray with me. Precious Lord, we thank you again for this beautiful day. We see the leaves are changing, and we remember that our lives are not static. That there are seasons of growth and there are seasons of death. There are seasons of change and there are seasons of rebirth. May we rest in the fact that you are with us no matter what changes around us. God, we ask you to be with those who are facing changes, that are mourning the death. We mourn the death of those in our community, those who are sick, those who are lonely, who feel disconnected. God, we ask you to wrap your arms around those who are mourning, those who are sick, and those who are caring for them. May your peace that is beyond understanding be with them. God, we continue to seek your wisdom in this ever-changing world, in this time of confusion, in this time of a pandemic. Be with all of our leaders and our healers, our doctors, our teachers, our essential workers, our families, all that guide and make decisions for others. May your wisdom guide them. May your truth light their way. May your healing hands be in their hands. God, we are grateful for the connection. We are grateful for the connectional church. We are grateful that not only was this church built to be a light in the Blue Ridge Mountains, but that this light blessed us with Lise McRae, that blessed us with Cannon Hospital, that blessed us with Grandfather Home, that blessed us with our sister church in Guatemala, Arc de Donwe. May we bless them continuously with our prayers, with our time, with our intention and our action. May all those who came here to worship you today feel your presence and feel your love. May we extend that to them. We know that your Son, Jesus, extends a hand always. Let us pray as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Will you please stand and join me in singing hymn 720, Jesus Calls Us. That you are loved, that you are cherished, and that every day God, through Jesus Christ, is extending his hand to you. Let us have the actions and intentions and the faith to reach out and grasp it. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the communion of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of our glorious Creator God be with each and every one of you. You may be seated. If you are not a member of Banner Elk Presbyterian Church, I graciously say goodbye and thank you for being here. And we hope to see you again. If you are a member, we ask that you do stay here so that we have a quorum present for our congregational meeting.
Yeah, give him a moment. It's good. You're good. Congregation, having been called by the session and a quorum declared present, clerk as will be the clerk of the session, as is our practice, Susan Carter, back here. So let us open with prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, Father, Son, Creator. As we take up the business of this world, may it be turned by your Spirit to the business of your kingdom. May our actions bring glory and show honor to your name and the salvation we enjoy through your mercy. In that name of Christ our Lord, your people say, Amen. I'll now turn the meeting over to Don Hilsmeyer, who will present the business on behalf of the committee.
Good morning. I'll try to keep this under an hour.
Then I'm going to sit down.
The purpose of this meeting is for you to approve the selling of a piece of property owned by the church. This property is located in the Mountain Glen community, lot number 7 on Hemlock Drive. The property was a gift to Banner Elk Presbyterian Church on September the 7th, 2011. We've been trying to sell this particular piece of property for 10 years and have failed to do so. We used word of mouth, advertised within the congregation, and used several real estate agents. This has been a difficult piece of property to sell, and those of us that have looked at it, we understand why. It's not on the golf course in Mountain Glen, nor do you have a view. It looks like it'd be very, very difficult to build on. Over the past 10 years, it has cost the church $5,186.24 in taxes and Mountain Glen assessments. For those of us who live in similar communities, we know that time to time there are extra assessments that can come in any particular year. Stewardship and finance put the property on the market for $12,500 on September the 23rd of this year. We received an offer of $12,500, and the closing is scheduled for October the 12th. The committee, Stewardship and Finance, recommends the sale of this property. I would like to make a motion at this time. On behalf of Stewardship Committee, Session, and the Board of Trustees, I move that the corporation approve the selling of Lot 5, Hemlock Drive, at the Mountain Glen community in Newland. Since this motion came out of committee, we do not need a second. Do you have any questions?
Questions or discussion? I assume you're ready to vote. Do you have any further comments, Don?
Nope, no, sir.
All in favor of this recommendation from the committee, please signify so by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign, aye. I declare as moderator that the motion passes.
Thank you very much.
That concludes the call for this meeting, the work that you were called for. So let us stand and be adjourned with prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your graces, for gifts which come to the work of this congregation, and for our ability to use them and to share them throughout the world and this community. As we continue in our work today, in our worship of you, and in our celebrations, may we move this day and all days in the power of your Spirit and with your eternal blessing through Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray and your people say,
listen to the word that God has spoken. Listen to the one who is close at hand. Listen to the voice that began creation. Listen even if you don't understand.